have, I'll show you what I do have. This one, a split neutral density filter. What the heck is that? Looks exactly the one I just told you about. Except, it's not all this color. It graduates from clear up to, why would you need that? Why would you need that? This is minus two f-stops, this is transparent. Anybody ever taken a picture from a canoe across the horizon with this bright white sky and the beautiful tree line, and what do you get? You either get a beautiful tree line and this washed out sky, or get the beautiful sky and a black line across the picture. Okay, why is that? Because it's too far apart in exposure, the camera can't deal with it. Why would it? Why would it? So, to fix it, here's an example. All right, we were camped in Utah, and I'm like, oh, what a beautiful scene. So, this is what the camera told me to do. Look, the sun is beautiful, the sky, look at the foreground. And I said, well, okay, I'll emphasize the foreground, look what happened to the sky. Well, there's two ways to do that. I could take this image, and I could cut this out and put it on that image in Photoshop, okay? Or you can put this filter in front of the camera so that this part is up here and this part is down here, and all of a sudden the difference between the two become less, okay? And all of a sudden, voila, bingo. You end up with this, which is what you want. But you had to do something to trick it. That's what a split neutral density filter looks like. I've got one here. I'll show you what they look like.
Do they have free rotation for the gradient?
No.
Why?
You don't want. You know. Well, you can do it. You can do it upside down, right side up. Turn the lights on for a second, Michael?
Yes.
Here's what it looks like. Just a piece of plastic, optical plastic. I mean, it looks just like. Well, see, I have a holder that sits in front of the camera. And the holder operates up and down because why is there no hard line? Well, you don't want a hard line. You don't want to see the line. You want it graduated. So that's why it's called graduated neutral density filter. Okay? And you can hold that. You can put it in front of a point-and-shoot camera. It'll do, you know. It's not changing anything. It's just changing the way the sensor sees the image. Okay? You can use, if the sky is dark and the water's turned upside down. Okay? If it's bright over here and bright over here, you turn it that way or that way. Okay? That's all it does. It's a clever little device, you know, to take pictures that you couldn't physically do. And do I use it often? Not often, but when you want it, when you get an opportunity. Depends on how big they are, depends on, you know, varies depending on where you buy them. Depends on how dense it is, the denser they are, the lightest, they're more expensive. I haven't bought one in years, so I don't know. All right, how many of you have one? You got one? You need to go out and buy one? Only, first of all, if you're not using a tripod, it's going to be darn difficult to use. All right. All right. Here's another one. Polarized light. Did I skip a bunch of stuff here?
No.
I'm all right. All right. Polarized light. What is? Okay. Polarized light is light that hits something and reflects off it. Okay. And it vibrates at a different angle, okay, physics. So sunlight is not polarized. It comes in, hits the earth, bingo. But if it hits something, like in the atmosphere, it hits a dust particle or the ground or a shiny surface and it reflects, it becomes polarized. It's vibrating this way, and if it's polarized, it's vibrating this way. Which means when you look into this at the surface of the water, can you see into the water? No, you see the surface of the water because of the polarized light. You look into a window, you see into the window? No, you see the surface of the window. That's because of polarized light. Okay? So light is reflected at various angles, becomes polarized. Well, who cares? Well, there's a filter called a polarizing filter, and that's what it does. It removes the polarized light. Well, who cares? Why would we want to do that? Okay. It's the most widely used filter, and it simply removes polarized light. And it's round and it fits on the front of your camera and you rotate it. And as you rotate it, the image gets darker or lighter because removing light means it's making the image darker, right? So when you rotate a polarized filter, you take away light, that means you're going to need the principal ring, you're going to need more light to get the same exposure, right? But the camera will take care of that because it's in front of a lens. Minimum effect, maximum effect. So all of a sudden you've got this much light. Just fine. So what does it do? Well, I lost 2 f-stops of light. So to put that filter on and I turned it. Okay, you know, big deal. You just need to know that it happens. All right. So what does it do? Why do we care? Why all the big hooped up? Without, fine image, with, fine image, okay? I can see into the water, there's nothing to see, there's no light. But you can see how different it makes the image look. Today would be a grand day to use a polarizing filter, okay? Without, with. Sky really that blue? Yes, but we can't see it without a polarizing filter. Okay? All these photo magazines, you see all these brilliant blue skies and these saturated colors. Where's that coming from? We're using a polarizing filter because you get rid of all that bounce light that's creating contrast and so forth. So what I suggest, you get a polarizing filter. Yes. That what I would suggest that you be, when you buy sunglasses, you buy polarizing sunglasses? Of course you do. Do you pay more for those? Yeah. You know, you take them off, it's like, man, the world doesn't look anything. The world is the same, it's just that you've removed the polarizing light. So, you get very dramatic. On a day like today with a blue sky and white clouds, you'll go, ooh, wow, I didn't realize it looked like that. And it's a perfectly okay thing to do. All right.
So it can be used for high light, high contrast?
You use it to reduce high contrast.
Right.
Use it on high contrast systems and it or days and it'll get rid of high contrast.
But you wouldn't use it on low light?
You don't use it in low light, you don't use it on cloudy days. And you don't use it.
Would it work for moon photography?
No, that'd do anything. It'll just take light away. The other thing you have to remember is there's a little trick to it. If the sun is behind you or in front of you, and you use a polarizing filter, it won't work. The light is coming directly in, and it's not removing anything. It only works if the sun is. So you can go out and look at it, and you turn, and you'll see the effect go away. the polarizing sunglasses don't work well when you're looking right in the center. It's the same phenomenon that the light has to be coming across. But okay. So, if you want to spend some money, you got nothing else to do with a polarizing filter. Even if you have a point and shoot camera, because it works perfectly well. Take a point and shoot camera, and what did I do? Give you an opportunity, you need to know what I'm going to tell you, because I want you to know what the opportunity is. Okay? So, it's macro photography. It's getting close to the subject. Okay? You physically approach the subject, you make little subjects big. That's all it is, all right? And I guarantee you, if you give someone a telephoto lens and have them document imicron, you give somebody a macro lens, you have you document imicron, you're going to get two totally different perspectives. All right? As E.O. Wilson said, macro photography depicts the little things that run the world. You're going to see things that no one has ever seen before. I photograph things that no one has ever photographed before, but still because I'm looking, I'm magnifying them. Alright, so as far as I'm concerned, it's an essential element of any photographer's repertoire. It's an important skill for you guys to have. So, your cameras have macro capabilities, most of them you need to learn to use them, okay? And different macro capabilities depending on the sophistication of the equipment. So we're going to talk about that, you know, try to walk in both fields here. Why? Believe it or not, it is within the sun's rays that most life on Earth occurs. Do you believe that? 95% of all species on the Earth are less than 5 millimeters long. It means if you're not looking at them, you're kind of missing out on the big picture, right? The big picture. So, 1 square meter of prairie out here, you take 30 centimeters, 1 square meter, this is the number of organisms in that square meter. And I guarantee you, almost all of them have never been photographed, most of them have never been described, right? Who works on crap like that? And yet it's this stuff that makes things work. It makes soil, it makes, you know, degrades detritus, it does all these ecological things you need to do. So it's an important component, and it's nice to photograph it. Right? Why not? Spring tails of imicron. You know, the columella imicron. Cool. The millipedes of imicron. You know, you'll have people lining up to buy that one. That's right. So, we call it a brave new world, macro photography. You know, it's the bulbs, it's the insects, it's the organisms that live on the underside of a sycamore leaf. Did you know there's an ecosystem on the underside of a sycamore leaf? You ever looked at it closely? It's populated by at least 4 different species of tinges, place bugs, and by 3 different species of predatory mites that prey on the tinges, and by all the debris and all the air. And you ever looked at the outside of a sycamore leaf, it's full of spines, you know, there's aisles, there's this whole world underneath the sycamore leaf.
Did you take a picture of the bowl?
Yes.
How far away were you?
3 inches. That's Vern, by the way.
Also, that's
Vern the Vol.
That's Vern the Vol, yeah. One of our scientists, not a captive vol, it was just one, it's not a tame vol, it was a captive vol that she had in her. And if you gave her a seed, it would come up, and photographing bulbs in the wild is tough. So it's about getting close to nature. That's what it's about. Right, and it's cool. There's lots of, there's more butterfly here. There's lots of different ways to do it. Lots of different ways to do it. And you can approach it. You can approach it with your point and shoot. You can approach it with your 35 millimeter. You can approach it lots of different ways. And we're going to show you what those ways are and where you fit in. All right. So to do that, we need to talk about some things. We need to talk about the language. Macro photography is measured in percentages of life size. If you buy a macro lens, it'll say half life size, third life size, fourth life size, fifth life size. What the heck does that mean? It means a life size image is as large in life. If it's 2 millimeters long, it's 2 millimeters long on this sensor. That's life size. That's all it means. It's nothing changed, right? All right. For example, there's three subjects. This one, the subject here is half it is in life, so that's half life size. That means the macro lens will allow you to get an image that is half as big.